want to focus on the Federal Reserve itself for a moment, in that I wonder, you know, what percentage of the people know that the Federal Reserve is not really a part of the government, a privately owned corporation, and who owns that, you know, the Federal Reserve? Well, could you have a comment on that?
Well, I think very few people understand how it works because the members of Congress weren't really very much aware of it. But I think it's a little bit worse than just saying it's private. You know, if it were just private, they'd have to live within the laws of the land
open
of fraud, and they would have to be a public corporation. And, you know, if
open their
there's
books.
A public corporation, you have a right to know what your corporation is doing if you own stock.
And be audited.
Here it's secret, but where do they get their power? Is it the power of the marketplace that creates this corporation? No, they, in addition to being very secretive, have their authorization, their creation from government. So the government creates them, and they create a special thing. So it's much worse than just being a private corporation. It is a very secretive, private, government-ordained corporation that has the power to counterfeit money. So it's very, very unique and much worse than just being private. It's the secrecy of it and the power that it gets through government legislation that makes it so evil.
Now, you were the ranking Republican on the House Banking Committee for a while.
On House one of the subcommittees, but not on the entire committee.
And do I understand correctly that members of Congress can't even go to the Fed meetings?
That's right. I was very interested in the issue, and I was on three subcommittees, two being on coinage and domestic monetary policy subcommittee. But I could not go to a meeting. I couldn't get an audit. I couldn't even check the books. And they're the ones who create the money. Yet I felt like I was elected to be responsible to the people, when I would be inquisitive and looking into these things. Their attitude is, when you need to know, or when the people need to know, we'll tell you. They're in charge, and we're just on the outside looking in, rather than the people being in charge of the government sending me or somebody else as their congressman to control the bureaucrats. Let's turn it upside down. They have control, and they allow us to know what we want and what they think we should know.
Now, what does the Federal Reserve System actually do? So many people say, you know, I see this in the Federal Reserve. I don't know what the Federal Reserve Bank does, and why is it so significant?
Well, it does several things. One of the benign things it does, and in some ways efficiently, and that is they exchange checks. You know, they're an exchange bureau, but that could be done very easily privately. The real evil that they do is they create money and credit. If the federal government runs up a debt, and they tend to have a habit of doing this, you know, and Congress is, you know, run by Republicans and Democrats, so they all spend money, they run up the debt. Of course, they, when they spend, they have to tax us. If they can't tax enough, then they have to borrow. And if they can't borrow enough, then they have one other option. They can tax and borrow, inflate. Inflate. The most important thing to remember is inflating is not the prices. And the prices go up after the money is inflated, and the money loses its value. So the Fed is designed to accommodate the politician in a very secretive manner. The politicians spend the money because the special interest is going to say, we want this, we want this. The politician gets reelected, so he's rewarded. And the tax becomes an indirect tax. Instead of going directly to the people, what the Federal Reserve does is they can take a treasury bill, accept the treasury bill, which now is just a mere computer entry. They accept the treasury bill of $10 billion. And they give Treasury $10 billion in their checking accounts. Where did the Federal Reserve get the money? Right out of thin air, right from heaven. They create the money, they put it in the checking account, and the Treasury spends it. And then that means that the people who got that money immediately get to spend it, and it has value. But as it circulates in the economy, the value of the purchasing power of the money goes down, and you have prices going up. The bad part about this is not everybody suffers equally. If the money supply went up 10% and every one of us had the cost of living go up identically 10%, there wouldn't be nearly the great harm. But because of the system, it's designed literally to benefit the politicians and the bankers and big corporations, those who get the money. They get the money, they get the benefit, and then somebody else in a year or two or three suffers the consequences.
Well, we read about the Federal Reserve as a banker's bank, and we see them that they raise the discount rate or they increase the money supply. What do all these things mean?
Well, the banker's bank means literally that the bankers are required to put their deposits in the Federal Reserve System, and they're accountable to the Federal Reserve System. They have to send in the reports to the Federal Reserve, and the Federal Reserve has all these regulations and rules, so they control the whole entire banking system. If in their efforts to fine-tune, although they literally destroy the money, they don't want to destroy the money. They want to control things so when inflation gets perking along, they're aware of the same economic thoughts that I'm aware of, and they know that if they're not a little bit cautious about this, they could have, you know, runaway inflation. So they tend to back off. But they benefit from the backing off. That means they tighten the credit, raise the interest rates, and cause a recession. And they do it in the name of saving the economy, which they have to, or the currency gets out of control. But if they know it's coming, then they benefit on it too. Then they benefit. They know then to be in cash and earn high interest rates, and the banks benefit by it. So they, whether the economy is going up or down, if they're designing the policy, they can catch the swing. So it's the inside information that they have. But if they didn't give the recessions, which are literally the results of the inflation, the system would crumble much faster. But our argument as hard money people is that in spite of their arrogance to think that they can keep this going forever, and as powerful as they are, the market is more powerful. See, for decades they kept the gold price at $35 an ounce. They said, we will regulate the price of gold. But they kept printing the money. The market finally broke down the price of gold. Well, the marketplace will finally win out, and the people will wake up and say, it's all a paper, it's all a scam. And that's when there's chaos, and that's when the bankers realize they're getting out of control, and that's when the connection of the bankers to the politicians is critical, because then power is threatened. So that's when they come down with political controls of our lives. That's why the emergency powers are already written. The president can declare an emergency and take over the industries and take over our lives and confiscate the gold. And that's why we should be concerned. We should be concerned for, you know, our prosperity, you know, our standard of living and all. But our greatest concern ought to be that when these crises come in, the market disrupts this political system and this monetary system, then we're threatened by political power taking away more of our personal liberties.
Are this the FEMA regulations that you're talking about, the
program? Yes, it's done under the FEMA, the emergency powers, and it came up even in the Contra hearings that there were emergency powers written. As a matter of fact, that great hero Oliver North was participating in designing some of these to literally, if necessary, suspend the Constitution. Mm-hmm. These are the kind of things they're talking about. I don't know if you recall.
Set up concentration camps.
This was brought up in the FEMA, in the Iran-Contra hearings, remember? They immediately suppressed it, and they say, this is something we can't discuss in the open.
Security, yes.
People aren't allowed to know about this.
Yeah.
And that's why, who protected this information? Who protected Oliver North? The head Democrat, which goes to show you the power structure is the same.
John, you've made a big study of the history of the Federal Reserve. How did it come about?
Well, it's a murky story, and I think that maybe 1913 ought to be the year that went down in infamy in American history, because not only did we get just barely in 1913 the Federal Reserve, we also got the income tax in that very same year, and those two things have worked to our been a very negative thing in our society and in our economy ever since that time. But it was a very secretive thing. It really goes back to the bankers getting in a sealed railway car and sneaking off to Jekyll Island, Georgia. And it was a very secret meeting. In fact, they called it the First Name Club. They only called each other by their first name so that even people who worked there as waiters and servants and so forth later couldn't identify for sure who had even participated in that meeting.
Well, it was only about four or five people, wasn't it?
Well, it was about 10, I believe, or 12. And that group of people literally laid the basis for what became the Federal Reserve.
Basically Rockefeller, Morgan people?
That group, you probably know something in that area.
Colonel House was involved there, and the Woodrow Wilson people were there, although this occurred, I believe, in 1910 or so when they met
Jekyll
at
Jekyll Island. That's right. It was a couple of years later.
By the time it got planned, it was finally passed in 1913.
It was kind of sneaked through Congress, and Wilson actually signed that into law, the Federal Reserve Act, like 2 days before Christmas. And when many of the senators and congressmen, of course, with transportation in 1913 being what it was, they had long since left the nation capital, many of them, but the ones that they wanted to stay and vote did stay and vote. Wilson signed the law 2 days before Christmas, and traditionally, hasn't that been a period where, by gentleman's agreement, that important legislation is not enacted right around the Christmas holiday?
It may be a gentleman's agreement, but that's generally the time that I was always most vigilant, because I realized that's when most of the garbage would be passed and most of the more honest onerous. You know, on the last day of the session is unbelievable. Stacks and stacks of pieces of legislation come in, and nobody reads anything. So the worst things happen at a particular time, but it is supposed to be that if the members aren't attending, that they wouldn't be doing these kind of things. But you're absolutely right. There was a very low attendance, and it was an unusual year because generally Congress didn't meet that late in the year, and I don't know whether they were called back into session or what, but it was unusual for Congress back in those days. Now it's very common to meet all year round.
So
back then they were usually only in session 2 or 3 months of the year, but here they were in session in December. Very unusual year.